My name is Peter Schwartz. I'm a professor of German and comparative literature in the Department of, what's it called? Modern Languages and Comparative Literature. Since we changed the name, I get confused all the time. And this, at the far end of the table, is my colleague Anna Zielinska-Elliott, who's a senior lecturer in Japanese and head of our Japanese program. Although there are plenty of complimentary things I would like to say about Yoko Tawada, in fact, Anna will be the one to give a real introduction to our guest and her work. My role will just now is simply to thank the people and institutions who have made it possible for Yoko Tawada to be here today. This event is jointly organized by the Center for the Study of Europe and the Center for the Study of Asia at Boston University and co-sponsored by the Department of Modern Languages and Comparative Literature, the Goethe Institute Boston, and the Japan Society Boston. We'd like to thank both centers and all of our co-sponsors for their support. Before I turn the microphone over to Anna, I'd just like to give you a general sense of how things will proceed. Once Anna is done introducing, Ms. Tawada will speak, after which there will be a conversation led by me and Anna. That is to say, Anna and I will each ask a question to get things going, and then we will open the floor to your questions and comments. There's a microphone over there. You should know that the event is being videotaped with that large machine back there, so please go up to the microphone to ask your questions in an adequately amplified fashion. And also, please do turn off your cell phones right now, because cell phones can be really annoying. Okay? Anna?
So good afternoon, everybody. We are delighted to welcome Yoko Tawada to Boston University. She is, as you know, one of the best known figures of the contemporary world literature scene. She writes in a wide range of genres, including novels, short stories, poems, essays, radio plays, texts for the theater, and experimental performance pieces. At the center of many of her narratives is a woman who, like Ms. Tawada herself, straddles two cultures. She was born in Tokyo, but has been living in Germany since 1982, first in Hamburg, but presently she lives in Berlin. She started by studying Russian literature at Waseda University, and later she moved to Hamburg with apparently only a rudimentary knowledge of German grammar. Maybe she'll tell us more about that. A few years later, she took up the study of German literature and went on to get a PhD from the University of Zurich for a dissertation titled Toys and Language Magic in European Literature. But by then, she had already started publishing poems in German and quickly became a prize-winning author, notable especially for achieving the unusual distinction of mastering literary craftsmanship in not one but two languages, Japanese and German. Her first book in German appeared in 1987 when she published a bilingual collection of poetry translated from Japanese. 2 years later, she published Das Bad, translated as The Bath, a story translated from Japanese. In 91, her first Japanese novella, Missing Heels, won the New Writer's Prize of the literary magazine Gunzo. Another novella, The Bridegroom Was a Dog, won the prestigious Akutagawa Prize in 1993. By 1996, the year she won Germany's prestigious Chamisso Prize given to outstanding foreign writers writing in German, Ms. Tawada had written the prose piece Ein Gast and a collection of literary essays, Talisman, both in German. A collection of prose fiction and poems written in German and Japanese with the title Where Europe Begins. In 1999, she spent some time in Boston, in Cambridge, as Max Kade Distinguished Visitor at the Department of Foreign Languages and Literatures at MIT. It would take too long to name all her publications and literary prizes, so I'll stop here for now and just tell you that some of her novellas and stories have been translated into English since the early 90s, and her work is widely admired in the United States by both readers and critics. First, Where Europe Begins was published in 2001, followed by Bridegroom Was a Dog in 2003, Facing the Bridge in 2005, and it was named the best book of the year by the Times Literary Supplement. In 2009, her first truly bilingual novel, The Naked Eye, written simultaneously in German and Japanese, was published in English translation from German. She described her approach to writing and language in an essay titled Exophony, stressing that what's important is not each individual language, but the space between them. She said, I don't want to be an author who writes either in language A or language B. I want to find that poetical ravine that divides the two and tumble into it. Elsewhere, I have found her quoted as saying, I was born into Japanese the way one is thrown into a sack. That's why Ms. Tawada has described her approach to writing and language in an essay, I am very sorry about this. She's quoted as saying she was born into Japanese the way one is thrown into a sack. That's why this language became, for me, my external skin. The German language, on the other hand, I have swallowed whole, and it has been sitting in my stomach ever since. As a translator myself, and as someone who also to some degree straddles two or possibly three cultures, I have a deep appreciation for Ms. Tawada's profound engagements with the mysteries and nuances of language. We will hear from her directly about this and other things in a moment, but I would like to read just a very brief quotation from an interview given in 1999, in which I think captures the predicament of all language beautifully. She said, I think it's an illusion to believe the mother tongue to be authentic. The mother tongue is a translation from nonverbal or preverbal thoughts too. Language is not natural for us, but rather artificial and magical. People who like to believe that language should be identical with human emotions and thoughts do not like to speak foreign languages. They feel that they have to pretend to be somebody else, or even that they have to lie when they speak foreign languages. Foreign languages draw our attention to the fact that language per se, even one's mother tongue, is a translation. This sensitivity to both the limits and possibilities of language is one of the things that has won Ms. Tawada worldwide popularity. Tonight she will give us a lecture, and after that she has agreed to take part in an open discussion. So please join me in welcoming Yoko Tawada to Boston University.
Good evening. I like cities with the names, the letter B on the top. So that's why I live in Berlin. And I also like Budapest, and I like Bordeaux. But it's not the only reason why I like Boston. Boston is my first city in the United States, which is very important for me. I stayed here for 4 months at MIT, and it was a wonderful experience for me. But today, I want to begin my talk with another B city. It's Bergamo in Italy. I'd been invited to Bergamo to speak on the topic emotion. I thought it would be a shame if my talk didn't have any Italian sounds in it. But what could I do? I don't speak Italian. Then it occurred to me that I'd learned some Italian words in my music lessons to be able to understand the notes. Most of these words had to do with speed, accelerando, or volume, pianissimo. There are even some that indicated an emotion, for example, piangendo, lamenting, or triste, sad. Maybe I could find enough words in a dictionary of musical terms to cover all the emotions in my text. I liked the idea of speaking about feelings in a language I'd never learned. Feelings speak a different language than we do. Feelings cannot be artificially produced, but they can be artistically represented by changing the tempo and volume. It's good to be able to speak a language, but not being able to speak a language ought to have advantages as well. In 12th century Japan, when overripe court culture was beginning to rot in its own bittersweet perfume, and it became necessary to abandon the main stage of politics to the professional fighters, the samurais, a new sort of dance arose that was known as shirabyoshi. The representatives of this new dance were women dressed as men with a sword at the hip, Perhaps it was a leftover of the shamanic tradition in which a change of gender was understood as a sign that the person in question had come in contact with the god. At that time, the Japanese capital, Kyoto, was home to two sisters, Gyo and Ginyo, who were celebrated as young, talented shirabyoshi dancers. The older sister, Gyo, soon became the concubine of Kiyomori, the most powerful samurai of the day, who saw dance as an indispensable part of life. Kiyomori provided Gyo with a villa in Kyoto so that her family could live there, though she herself spent most of her time with him at his residence. Her mother, who had eaten bitter rice long enough after the death of her husband, rejoiced at the carefree life she was able to lead in the elegant villa. Taira no Kiyomori, omoomoshiku maestoso, imperioso, yudaina sora, grandioso, yotsu no umi o shihai shi, kowai mono nashi yaritai houdai, seken no soshiri mo kaerimizu, itsumo kimaguri, kaprichoso, yokubou mori mori hijoushiki, hoshii mono wa nan demo hoshii, hoshii toki ni hoshii, sutetai mono wa nan demo suteru, sutetai toki ni suteru. Ane to imouto, gyou to ginyo, shirabyoushi no odoriko shimai ga kyou no miyako de hyouban ni natte iru. Kiyomori wa ane no gyou ni koi o shite, atsuku atsuku appassionato, chouai suru favore favore. One day, another dancer appeared in the capital, attracting all the city dwellers' attention. She was 16 years old, came from the Kaga region, and was called Hotoke. You couldn't tell if it was her talent or her youthful beauty that made her whole being so radiant. She loved herself because her audience loved her. Even the wind always blew in the way that favored her, so she had not yet experienced a single defeat. One day, she thought, I have made a name of myself as a shirabyoshi dancer, but Kiyomori, the most powerful man of our time, had not once invited me to perform for him. Today, I shall invite myself to his house in accordance with street artist customs. Hotoke set out for Nishihachijo, where Kiyomori had his residence. 3年後, 舞踏会の天空に現れた新しい星。年は16、名前は仏、自信満々、私が一番。とは言うものの、まだ清盛様の前で踊ったことがない。お呼びがないならこちらからお仕掛けましょう。仏は大胆、アニモーサメンテ。 When Kiyomori heard there were dancers who wanted to see him and that she was already standing at the gate, he was seized with fury. Someone who enjoys too much power as he did can easily be taken aback. He said to his concubine, Gyo, this girl has invited herself to my home. What outrageous impertinence. Artists should appear only when I send for them. Besides, all dancers are bowing compared to you. Send the conceited creature home. She should consider herself fortunate to be sent away without punishment. Meanwhile, Hotoke had crept into the courtyard and was listening at the door. Kiyomori's hard words injured her pride. She wanted to leave, but then overheard the word Gyo was saying to Kiyomori. I know the customs of the street artists. They visit the court without an invitation to show their art. They are free in their behavior, and the only rule that governs them is that of gravity. Hotoke is still very young and inexperienced. If she wants to visit you, this is because of the reverence for you. 清盛勝手に押しかけてきた仏のずうずうしさにイライラ怒りイーラ怒りイーラ怒ってラッピア腹を立てるが義王が取りなす芸術家は呼ばれなくても芸を見せに来るものですしかもこの子は若くて純粋インノチェンテ追い返すもんじゃありません清盛 grew calm again and said very well let the girl come in and dance for us set up the stage in those days wealthy samurais had dance stage in their homes for them dance was not only a matter of aesthetic pleasure but also the archive of knowledge crucial for survival dance was a record of the body positions and movements from which fighting techniques were derived and a source of new ones complex knowledge that could not be notated on paper was inscribed in the dancing body. And this was an excellent method, since even if video cameras had existed in the 12th century, it wouldn't have been possible to film every view of every muscle and bone for every movement and to preserve these shots in such a way as to make them useful in real life. 仏は屋敷に上がってすぐにスビート、すぐにトスと踊り出す。はじめは静かにカルマート、だんだん早くアッチェルランド、優雅にグランディオーソ、そして華やかにブリッランテ。清盛は目が離せない。仏を慈しむ心が芽生え、燃え上がる火のようにコンフォーコ、熱狂的に、パッシオナータメンテ。This story is too long to read today, so I'll put the whole story on my homepage this week. So if you visit my homepage this week, you can read the end of the story. Goethe came back from Italy, greatly enriched, but by no means satisfied. I found this sentence in the Life and Works of Goethe. When I came back from Italy, greatly enriched, but by no means satisfied. I always wrote a travel narrative before I set off on a trip so that during the journey, I'd have something to quote from. I always shrieb a travel narrative before I set off on the trip so that during the Reise, I'd have something to quote from. Ich always schrieb a travel narrative before I set off a trip, damit during the Reise I have something to quote from. Ich always schrieb einen Reisebericht before I set off on a trip, damit ich während der Reise something daraus zitieren konnte. Ich schrieb immer einen Reisebericht vor der Reise, damit ich während der Reise etwas daraus zitieren konnte. Uninvited guest. Guests from distant lands receive a warm welcome in Germany. Everyone speaks English to them, and having an opportunity to speak English seems to put a lot of Germans in a good mood, as if it offers them a way to free themselves from the performance anxiety and control mania that are now an inextricable part of the German language. The Czech neighbor of Japanese woman I know in California once told me that in Germany, he'd much rather speak English than German. When he speaks English, he said, he is warmly received as an American guest. But the moment he switches to German, he's immediately relegated to the category Mitteleuropa. On account of his silent accent, a category many Germans privately think of derogatorily as Eastern Europe. And right away, he's stripped of his status as a guest, but he doesn't get invited into the parlor of the German language either, even though everyone knows that an important subset of German language literature was written in areas that now belong to the Czech Republic. Romania and Poland. The Californian Czech asked me about my experience in Germany. In my case, I had to admit, the accent in my face is even bigger than the one in my pronunciation. So I instantly get categorized based on my appearance. It makes no difference what language I'm speaking. I'm even welcome in that cozy parlor, since there is no danger of my becoming an undercover foreigner who can no longer be recognized as such. Still, I often find myself being interrupted by highly educated members of society with comments like, "It's astonishing how well you speak German," that I feel shut out and cannot go on speaking, or else they'll ask whether I am familiar with this or that German word. Their choice of words generally demonstrates that they have never seriously applied themselves to studying another language. They seem to find it unsettling to be confronted with a person who is neither one of them nor an outsider. Manche glauben, das Erlernen einer Fremdsprache sei Leistungssport und jeder Muttersprachler könne die Leistung messen. Dabei benutzen sie ihren bürgerlichen Geschmack als Messgerät. Wer den besitzt, kann sofort die genaue Zahl vom Gerät ablesen und sagen, wie gut ein Satz formuliert ist. Der eigene Geschmackssinn kann aber auch zum Verhängnis werden. Some people think of language learning is as a competitive sport in which the learners prowess can be judged by any native speaker. But they measure this prowess using their own bourgeois tastes as a gauge. Anyone sharing their sensibilities can just read off the score on the gauge to say how well a sentence is formulated. But a person's sense of taste can prove fateful. It took a long time before I was able to open myself sufficiently to my own native tongue, Japanese, to be able to appreciate sentences most Japanese speakers would stumble over. Dismantling one's native language and turning it into a construction site is back-breaking labor, a different sort of labor that is equally fascinating is putting a foreign language, which is like an eternal construction site, to literary use. When I'm writing, questions constantly come up in which linguistic topics take on poetological significance. For example, why do we have singular and plural forms? Why is a difference between one apple and two apples so important that it forces us to change the form of the apple, even though the distinction between two apples and three apples is apparently inconsequential? How can we justify the special status of singularity? Should a person who is not monotheistically inclined nonetheless accept this grammatical rule? In Russian, there is a form between the singular and plural that is responsible for quantities between two and four. There are the saints that stand between the one God and the plural populace. The first time I heard the greeting, "Grüß Gott," greet God in Munich, I spontaneously asked myself, which God should I be greeting? There are approximately 8 billion gods in Japan, but not a single article. All these thoughts that are occurring to me surely have something to do with the fact that I know Japanese. But my thoughts cannot be locked away in the asylum seeker's dormitory. known as a Japanese background. Die Kritiker, die glauben, sie können wie Schullehrer jeder literarischen Arbeit eine Note geben, können keinen Text unbenotet behalten. Was er nicht sofort beurteilen kann, kann er nicht in seinem monokulturell sauber aufgeräumten Denkraum dulden. Entweder landet die unbenotete Arbeit im Papierkorb oder sie wird auf einem fernen Ort, auf die Herkunft, abgeschoben. Weil sie sich auf ihrem bürgerlichen Geschmack blind verlassen, können sie oft das Fremdartige nur als das Minderwertige wahrnehmen. The critics who imagine they can assign grades to literary works like school teachers can't stand to leave any text ungraded. There is no room for works that cannot immediately be evaluated in their monocultural, tidied up mental space. The ungraded work will either wind up in the waste paper basket or be deported to a far-off land known as a foreign background, since they rely blindly on their bourgeois taste. Anything that looks foreign to them is inevitably seen as inferior in value. So they might choose between giving the foreign a negative grade or pointing out its foreignness in order to exclude it from the realm of locally produced realities. This latter method is the safest if they want to avoid being labeled xenophobic, anti-Islam, anti-Semitic, or Eurocentric. Foreign background is an island where temporary stays of exclusion are granted. Many authors are happy not to find themselves summarily dispatched. Others die of loneliness. The isle of their banishment lies so far away that its existence can easily be forgotten. I have here one poem in Japanese, and you can see four American ships that came to Japan at the end of the 19th century, Kurofune. It's the visual poem and also sound poem.
Muna, muna muna, muna muna gurushi. Munamuna gurushi murano, munamuna gurushi murano nakani, munamuna gurushi murano nakani mureru, munamuna gurushi murano nakani mureru murega, munamuna gurushi murano nakani mureru murega murette. Kuro, kurofune, kurofune ga kuru, kurofune ga kuru kuru, kurofune ga kuru kuru kurutte, kurofune ga kuru kuru kurutte mawatte, kurofune ga kuru kuru kurutte mawatte modotte, kurofune ga kuru kuru kurutte mawatte modotte, kurofune ga kuru kuru kurutte mawatte modotte, tennou sei modotte. Nami, nami nami, nami nami dabutsu, nami nami dabutsu o dabutsu. Hiro, hirobiro, hiro, hirobiro. Nonbiri, biri, biri demo ii. Hiro, hiroi.
And I have some poems I ask my friend Bettina Brandt to read the English translation of these poems, please. And I, during the reading, I write the kanjis on the paper and show you.
Person. The character for person looks so sparse. No brain, no shoes to wear. If it just had hands, it could light a fire. But it cannot create light or warmth on its own. What can a person who does nothing do? Stand on the sand and gaze at the sea, like the white rabbit at Inaba? His skin might be torn off by a crocodile. He might be thrown on a pile of firewood to be burned at the stake. Society seeks an unending supply of human sacrifices. They say the energy released as a body burns is clean and natural. Does the character for person look like it's walking, or does it seem to stand transfixed? Trees. The character stretches straight up to the length of its spine. At some point, it will strike the softness of the clouds. It shows the moment it thinks. There's no need to go any higher. And then people become trees, plum trees with crooked spines and covered in bumps. They say plants are in mammalian forms. They make cultures of color and form from only light, water, and carbon dioxide. They do not eat unnecessarily. That is to say, they can live without excreting foul-smelling waste from their entrails. Instead of building houses, they give their own bodies as homes to the caterpillars, to the woodpeckers, to the squirrels. Water. If ascending to the heavens is the job of a pilot, then falling from the heavens is the job of an angel. Water, too, is a band of good angels that falls and falls from the stitches of the clouds, stuck on the shoulder. They pelt down on the wet mirror of the highway and smash into spray. The road collects the drops and becomes a rushing river, which eventually becomes a large serpent that twists and turns, carving away the shores of people's land, carrying earth and sand. It carves away, leaving the face of the earth in relief. Rice. A pile of stars fills her bowl. The tips of the sharp ray of light sweetly sting the mouth of the ones who eat it. A refreshing breeze flows in behind their eyes. What looked like a spot on the wall is now seven mosquitoes, the hair of their legs clearly visible. They say eating star rice allows one to see into the distance. 30 kilometers away, a small child is visible, nose bleeding, as it plays with a crab. 3 years away, the window of an unmanned bank is visible as it blows in the wind, banging open and shut. Dog. A single man squats on the precipice. His left hand rubs the head of his dog, flat as a plate. He sticks out his right hand and lets it gently bite. He gazes at his palm, slick with saliva, takes off the dog's collar, replaces it with a chain of flowers, suddenly embraces it, presses his cheek against the dog's eyes, the tears well up. He embraces the dog's head firmly with both arms and then pushes the dog into the bubbling lava of the volcano below. Large. They say the character beauty means large sheep. They say the larger the living sacrifice, the less the misfortune. Even a small wind will soon bend the spokes of a big umbrella. They say that in prison, people die in the order of their height. Big people eat small people. Big countries hate small countries. Big mice respect small elephants. Thick. A time will come when dawn will melt into dusk. Warmth will mean the same as cold. Walk slowly and the station will feel nearer. A single cracker will fill our stomachs. And at the top, one wants to stop writing. A poem appears on the page. Not yet. It is still possible to speak now to those not yet dead. Inside my stomach are entrails I have still not touched. Someone I have not yet met consoles me for a crushing sorrow I have not yet felt. The language I use at that moment is one I have not yet started to learn. The poems I have not yet written are already written. I hope that the other creatures that I cannot yet imagine that will inhabit the earth far into the future will be far happier than us. End. At the end of the sleeve is a sensitive hand. At the end of the hem is a delicate yet strong ankle. At the end of thought is a breath. I raise one foot like a crane. I spread out my left hand, holding a fan like a wing, and I transform from woman into a bird, from bird to a letter. Come. I do not know where you stand. Is it the place where I once stood long ago? I hear a voice calling me, but I want to return only to places I have never been.
Thank you. Thank you. I have one more poem. It is about the question. To eat or not to eat, that is a question in Fukushima. とべ、とんび、とべ、とんび、とべ、とぶべきか、とばないべきか、とび、それとも or not to be、 それは問題か、クエと言われてもクエない、それが問題、クエスチョン。 福島のマッシュルームと書いてある、クエたら食ってあげたい、召し上がってくれよ、食べるな、ない、ない、ないんだ、クエ、クエ、クエスチョン、食べられるのか、福島のトマト、福島のキャベツ、 福島の大根ですと書いてある、八百屋のマジックペンで、クエ、クエズ、クエスチョン。 That is a question, whether安全か危険か、 危険だけど健康、いいえ安全だけど病気にはなる、調べたから安全です、数字で書く安全、 目の中の血管の赤信号、ピカピカ、 意識の中に、 in the mind含まれた苦悩、 suffer。 シェイクスピアが途切れ途切れに聞こえてくる、 海の向こうから、汚れた海の向こうから、 なぜ海を敵に回すのか、 死を海に垂れ流す、死ぬのは死なないのは、 Sea against a sea of troubles, 福島の to die, to sleep, no more, and by a sleep to say we end, 海の言語がわからない、もう息ができないと言っているのか、 それともまだ還元できると言っているのか、 海と話をすることができたなら、 and the thousand, 千代に八千代にこれから苦しむ natural shocks, 自然には還元されないショック、 耳を澄まして聞き取れる言語だけでも、波の間から集めて、書き留めて、 to die, to sleep, 眠らないで、クエ、 クエ、 question of, she, she, Shakespeare. Thank you.
So, yes. Anna and I were assigned the role of first question askers, sort of like conversational yeast. And so we sat down to think of at least one question to lead things off with. And so Anna began by asking me whether you sound like a German when you write in German. But we realized pretty quickly that this couldn't possibly be the right way to ask the question. Put that way, the question could mean all sorts of things, and it could also mean not very much at all. For instance, it could sound insulting. You might think that we were asking, do you make mistakes in your second language that a native German speaker would not make? And that's certainly not what we meant. Besides, I'm sure there are Germans who make mistakes. And then, which German person in particular might we justly expect you to sound like? You could sound like Goethe, or Walter von der Vogelweide, or my wife, or my mother-in-law, or Martin Walser, or a truck driver from Cologne, or all or none of them from one page to the next. To my ear, they don't all sound the same, and who knows what they think of each other. And what about Japanese? Do you sound like a Japanese person when you write in Japanese? And if so, which Japanese person? Akutagawa, Basho, yourself in 1980, Anna's friend Kayo? Do you feel obligated to sound like what German or Japanese people think Germans or Japanese should sound like? And then whose ears are we talking about? Do you think that when you read your own writing that you sound like a German when you write in German? Do you feel like you sound Japanese? Or are these entirely the wrong questions? What do you think is the right way to ask this question?
I don't know how German sounds or Japanese sounds. There are many Germans and German kind of sounds and also Japanese. And I think the sound of the poetry is something between the very personal breath and the, how people are talking nowadays in the society, the oral one, and the literature, the classical, Goethe, and so on. The mixture of three things, that's, and you make your own sound from that. So it must be the unique one. I don't want to sound like Goethe, even if I could. So, but for me, the German language by Paul Celan or Franz Kafka and also Walter Benjamin was very important. So they are all Jewish, German-speaking, German-writing people who lived outside Germany. So maybe it's my, yeah.
Other people who feel strange in their chosen language. Thank you. Anna, you have a question as well.
I found your talk very interesting, and there are a lot of things I would like to ask, but I have to pick one. So I thought I would ask about, for example, I would have liked to have asked about the Japanese background known as the asylum seeker's dormitory, but instead I will ask about feelings. You talked about the liking the idea of speaking about feelings in a language you had never learned, and you said that feelings speak a different language than we do. They cannot be artificially produced, but they can be artistically represented by changing the tempo and volume. And the reason I want to ask you a question about feelings is that I read an interview with you, an old one, in which you said that people often ask you how you can write literature in a language, in a foreign language, and that for them literature is something deep, something having to do with the unconscious. To which you said that it's not the depth of the text, but its surfaces, such as letters, the sound of words, slips of the tongue, and verbal games, which have something to do with the unconscious. And the surface is more conspicuous to someone who has not learned the language as her mother tongue. And then the interviewer said, so you believe that you cannot ever express feelings through language? And you said, no, never. So I was wondering if you could elaborate on that, because I think it's a very provocative statement and a really interesting one, and I think I know what you mean. But
okay, so I don't have to answer. I wanted to say that you cannot express emotion directly. You know, you can, of course, you can write, I am sad, but it's not literature, it's nothing. So if the sadness maybe in the tempo and the in the performance or in oral literature, it is in the music of the literature, so in the sound of the literature, and also in the letters. In the, for me, the letters are very important because they have nothing to do, directly nothing to do with the content. It's not the content, it's just a form. So it's a outside, it's a, like the unconsciousness. It is not, it does not try to be what I want to say. but it is still there. And without letters, you don't have literature. So it's a body of the literature. But you know what I think.
Okay. I thought I knew, but I wanted to make sure.
Yes, okay.
So can we now have maybe questions from the audience?
Would you like to sit or stand? What do you prefer? Sit here?
Yes.
Yes, okay. And you can have a line of sight. Yes, good. So there's a microphone there for anyone who would like to ask questions.
Oh, there's one there too.
Some people go both ways.
Two people can ask questions.
At the same time, in two languages.
Oh, yes. Any language that she speaks, I think, is okay.
No Russian, please.
She's Russian.
Oh, really? Oh, my Russian is so bad. Sorry.
My Japanese is non-existent. I found your work absolutely fascinating. I often struggle when I write in Russian, when I write my poetry in Russian. For an American audience, I've also played with this a little bit. I struggle because musically it makes a lot of sense often, but on the page it's a different alphabet. And you demonstrated to us very beautifully with the kanji characters that you can also do visual poetry just with the Japanese characters, which I find very inspiring. But I'm wondering, do you have longer length texts that are all kanji that are supposed to function in German or another language? Or do you present that to your audience? Does it work for them? How does that work?
I don't really know if one text or performance can work or not. I just try, and because especially in the United States, I can't know which people can understand which language and so on. But it's. But also, I think also when I write in German and read it in Germany, you are not sure if all people can understand it, or and each of them understand something else. So it's the same situation. It is, and it's not the most important thing to understand or not understand, to be able to explain or interpret the text or not. That's not the most important thing. The most important thing is to get that text as a literature, because it takes time. After that, you must begin to think about it. But at the moment, during the performance, the audience just gets the text and take it into the, I don't know which place, but some place in the body and take it home.
Mm-hmm. I may just follow up very quickly on that. So I guess what I'm wondering is, do you feel that there is also something centrally interesting visual of a whole page of Japanese characters for somebody who is not initiated into the Japanese language? Because there's this sort of division or debate right now in contemporary American poetry, where it's poetry for the stage, poetry for the page, and I think it's a mood distinction anyway, but some things are better designed, it seems, for one versus the other. So I guess that's what I'm asking.
I don't think the Japanese characters are not interesting to me when I lived in Japan. You know, they are very normal. I just see the content, but know the letters. But it's a foreign eyes, German eyes, that looking at this and asking me, what does it mean? it's interesting, and so. So it became for me foreign too. And the literature is, not for the page, also not for the stage, but it's a chance. The stage, also the page, is the only chance where we can meet the literature. So.
Thank you so much.
I wonder if I could ask you something that may be a slightly political question about the Chamisso Prize, one of your distinctions. It's given to German, to writers who write in German but who don't have German as a mother tongue. And I guess I just have been thinking and wondering whether you think that that's a wonderful thing that there is such a prize, or whether it is in some ways, you know, sort of singling out people who don't have German as a mother tongue as an oddity or something, but they need their own special prize. You know, I don't know of a comparable prize in English. It seems, and it's easy to think, well, that's just because English is already a sort of multi-centered language. You know, you might be writing in English in India or anywhere around the world, and many people have written in English very famously who didn't have English as a mother tongue, and they didn't get special awards for it. They're just English language writers, Nabokov and Conrad and so on. Or is it a useful stage for German, which has been less of a multicultural society? I just wonder what your thoughts are as a mm-hmm. recipient of this prize. I think it was founded at the Deutsch als Fremdsprache Institute at the University in Munich, and it's associated in my mind then with the thoughts about this whole field of German as a foreign language, which has become a rather interesting field in Germany for reflection on the concept of foreignness, the concept of nativeness, and seems to make room for many of the reflections you know, they sort of go in the directions that you have gone, or begin to go in directions that you've gone. Mm-hmm. But do you see what I'm asking? I'm wondering whether it sort of is a little bit of a spotlight, like the astonishment that you, as a Japanese person, could speak such good German and so on.
Yeah.
Or is it less complicated than that?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think it's a good thing about the Shamiso Prize, because it gives people chance to thinking about what does it mean. Some of Shamiso Prize winners have the German as mother tongue, or they came when they were babies, so German is a mother tongue, but they have still parents who speak other languages. And the Shamiso Prize is a chance to think about the people, focus on the subject, what does it mean to foreignness, to the literature, or mother tongue, and all these questions. Maybe they don't discuss about it if there are no Shamiso Prize. So that one reason why I like it. Another reason is that I like Shamiso, you know. So I want to have the prize with his name.
More people?
Hi, thank you. I was wondering if you could just tell us a little bit about your relationship to English. Because if I understand, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but you compose primarily in German and Japanese.
Yeah.
Do you also translate, because I know most of your published translations are not translated by you, but by others.
Yeah.
Do you translate some into English?
No.
The
no,
things
no,
so that
no.
so could you
like no.
Could
oh,
you
I forgot to say that the first text and the first and second text are translated by Susan Wernowski,
yes,
from German. And the last one, the poems that Bettina read, are translated from Japanese by Jeffrey Angus.
So could
and
you just...
English is just, I was invited to the United States. I was happy. I wanted to give talk, and people, I could do it in Japanese or in German, but then I had to and give two talks, you know, mm-hmm. but just, but, and it's interesting to put the whole kind of people in one room, so I had to speak or read in English. That's the only reason why. But English is, I have no relationship with, not correct, but English is not my language.
Yeah. So what is it like to read your own work translated by another? I'm just curious to hear your idea,
yeah,
how you feel in that moment.
Yeah, I like the translation in because I can see my text with how can I explain it? When I was new in Germany at the beginning of the 80s, I couldn't write in German, so I wrote in Japanese, and someone else, Peter Pörtner, translated it into German. And then I read the translation, and it was like the, you know, when you write a poem, you don't understand what you are writing, but you read the translation, so you understand what you did. It's like the mirror. Yeah, you can't see yourself, but in the mirror of translation, you understand what you wrote. It's a wonderful experience. Also in English, today I understood what I wrote.
I wanted to ask about the translations of your books written in German into Japanese. Have you ever considered? You wrote some books in German only, right? And they must.
They are not translated into
they
Japanese.
They are not? None of them are?
Yes. Three of you mean the Opium for Beat. And this, yes. Two books, I think two or three books, I translated it them into Japanese. Yes.
How did it feel to translate your own books written in German into Japanese?
One gets very close to the people one translates.
Yeah, it's very difficult to translate the my own works, but I wanted to do it because to discover another way of writing in Japanese. You know, when I write in Japanese, I have my style, but to discover another style, and I have another style in German, so it was experiment to translate my own text into Japanese. But the first, my first experiment was Henshin no tame no opium, opium shall be it. And it was very difficult, and my reader said that they didn't understand the book. Yeah. And the second one was The Naked Eye. I wrote the book in Japanese and in German at the same time. So I wrote in Japanese some sentences and translated it into German and continued writing in German and translated these sentences into Japanese. And it was also not easy because when you change a Japanese text, you must change the German text too. And you change the German text and you read through the text and it is not good, so you must change the German text, and at the same time you must change the Japanese text. And they are two different, how can I say, animals, you know? They didn't want to get together, go in other directions.
But so you felt you needed to make them as similar as possible?
Yes, I tried to. The tiger and the lion. And this is the first time that I wrote one book in Japanese, Yukino Renshusei, and translated it into German, Etude in Schnee. And it was more difficult than translating from Japanese from German into Japanese.
Hi. I just want to thank you for your lecture. And one of the things that sort of stuck with me was this concept of a sort of a bourgeois taste, this sort of upper middle class complacency within one's culture, where, you know, it doesn't really matter if you're a Jew from Brooklyn or someone from Saitama or someone from Bavaria, people sort of know where to put you. And I feel like that's exacerbated when you talk about sort of different cultures. And I was wondering if you found that as more of a tool or an obstacle in terms of writing your work and putting your work out to people. And sort of both in the construction and the reception of it, and also as someone who's been in Germany, like you said, for 30 years, right? For a very long time, do you think that's sort of just a symptom of society, or do you think that it's becoming different? Do you find that, like, when in 1982, when you moved to Germany, it was more prevalent or less prevalent now? Sort of a two-parter. So for the first one is, do you find it as an obstacle or a tool? And the second one is, do you think that there's anything that can be done about this sort of, I guess, reluctance of openness to other cultures in a way? Thank you.
The bourgeois taste?
Yeah, the bourgeois taste. I mean, I think that when you're dealing with someone, especially someone who can't speak your own language, there's a tendency to see them as sort of uneducated or sort of less. Definitely if you're in your home country as a native speaker. And I was wondering if, you know, that's gone away, if there's anything that can be done about it, and how you dealt with that when you were writing your work.
Is that what you mean by bourgeois taste, a certain provincialism? Or
provincialism?
I mean,
a sort of attitude of like, oh, good for you. You can, like, you learned our language. Like, Congratulations, oh, the dog can talk, kind of a way. You know, where it's
a self-congratulatory provincialism.
Yeah, like a very trivial, like commendation, but I mean, you don't really want that. Like, it's such a, yeah, like sort of like a trivialization of effort that you put into something. And there's this guy that's never, you know, studied any other language and has no sort of linguistic background or anything like that, and simply by existing sort of, you know, transfers that upon to you, if you know what I mean.
No.
I mean, like, okay, so when you're saying, like, when they were quizzing you on words in German, right? I feel like that's sort of a little bit, you know, like a parlor game or like a spectacle.
Maybe if you discuss more what you meant by the bourgeois, what is the term? I forget now.
Yeah, bourgeois taste.
Bourgeois taste. I mean, what you mean by that? When you used it in your work.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
How it figures. I mean, I think you're suggesting that
it
can figure as something difficult, but also as something to make art from, or.
Yeah, right. As sort of like maybe that your work was in some way enhanced by your reaction to that, by facing this wall or whatever or however you saw it, either as, you know, this is really frustrating, this is sort of limiting to how people see me, or this is sort of an opportunity to say something with a little bit more significance.
It's a question about sort of how one can be ambivalent about obstacles, right?
Yeah, it's sort of like people don't generally like to be shaken up from their everyday life, and having to deal with someone who is foreign and educated and doesn't really fit into your society as well as you do, but is here.
I meant with a bourgeois taste, there is one only monocultural, one kind of bourgeois in Germany, who they have all common, they read the certain books and they know certain things and they find one style of German language very good,
right.
You know? Right. Mm-hmm. And there are other foreigners, they are not uneducated, but they have other literatures and other taste and
certainly
other cultures, you know? So, on the stage of literature, the bestsellers and also the high literatures, the people who organized it, who decide who gets the prize and so on, these mm-hmm. people are too, for me, too monocultural,
sure.
You know? Too maybe provincial, but yeah.
Right, and I'm saying, I'm saying that sort of, you know, like they read all the right books, and you read different books, right?
Yeah,
that's
right,
that's not the right book.
Right.
You didn't go to the right school. So I'm saying, as someone who's spent their entire career in that country, having to come up, and having to be sort of break through that wall, I'm saying, do you find that was difficult, and that sort of hindered your attempts to write poems and novels, or do you think that it gave you a sort of a kind of a like a gray area within German culture? Because I feel like every culture has that society. You know, like you went to Waseda, for example, and that would be great if you were working in Japan. People would really respond to that less so than they would if you work in Germany. So what I'm sort of trying to get at is, was that a tool or, like I said, an obstacle?
Mm-hmm. And you have always barrier and problems with writing. You can't say it is a problem or it is a good inspiration. It's the same thing. You sure. have always enemies and the walls and barriers, and that it belongs to the writing.
Sure. Then maybe I'll just change it up a little bit. Rather than writing the word, how about the reception? Just the way that you talk about your first maybe five published things in Germany.
Yeah.
The way that you saw them.
Yes, my first.
Sorry, book, this is like great.
Yes, my first book was the book with poems, and for me, Nur da wo du bist, da ist nichts. And the critics said it's just surrealism. You know, surrealism is gone in Europe. It's just a historical thing. But in the outside Germany, surrealism is not gone. Mm-hmm. You know.
So you sort of gave them something.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you for a wonderful talk. One of the many borders you cross is actually between poetry and fiction, which is actually something increasingly rare these days to have writers who do both and do both well. And you have different audiences for each, at least here. For example, mostly in English, only your fiction has been translated other than a few things by Jeffrey Engels. But I was wondering if this distinction between fiction and poetry or prose and poetry is a useful one for you as someone who does both, or are you doing something different when you write your poetry and when you write prose and fiction?
I must choose a form each time. What I have one idea, and the poem is sometimes the poem poetry is the right form for this idea, or and very often I didn't find the real form, but it's between prose and right. poem, or between the dialogues and the theater, or between something. So most of my texts, you can't put it to one genre, but it's right. rather looking for the for the. Genre. And I don't think now I'm writing poems or I'm writing prose, and to write poems I have to do this and this and that. It's not my way to write, but I have the idea, I have pictures, image or idea, and I just want to find the form, and it's no matter people call it prose or poem or theater, or because I think each idea need the house where it mm-hmm. can live. Yeah.
Are your ideas language specific? When you feel inspired to write something, do you feel inspired to write it in German or in Japanese, or does that come later?
Sometimes it comes later. When I have a story, I don't know if I should write it in German or in Japanese. But if I have the image, the one single image, I know it is German or Japanese.
Please.
Hi. I aspire to be a writer, and I guess my end goal is to write novels or stories or even manga in Japanese. But right now, I am unable to, I guess, properly express myself in Japanese. And I was wondering, like, I'll write something in Japanese and I'll feel as though I've said exactly what I meant to say, and I'll hand it to a native Japanese speaker and they won't have any idea what I just wrote. So I was wondering if you find it more important that you've said what you wanted to say, or if other people understood what you wanted to say.
I usually don't want to say anything, you know. I just have the sentence or words, and say, to make the building with the words and to make the literature, it's like the architecture. And what the people think or they understand, it's not my problem, you know? So you can just work with the language itself.
Thank you.
Of course, yes, please.
Okay, thank you again for coming to speak. My question, well, first I want to say that in the readings that you did of your work, there is a very beautiful immediacy to your choice of words, and it was very impactful. And my question relates to the moment of linguistic creation. So when you write, how do the various languages inside you interact with each other before they actually take written form? Do they battle or dance with each other? Do they live harmoniously in you, or are they distrustful or even jealous of each other?
Wie die Sprachen, also bevor sie was schreiben, wie die Sprachen also untereinander sind, also kämpfen oder eifersüchtig aufeinander
sind. You mean Japanese and German?
Yeah.
They try to kill each other.
Yeah, eifersüchtig.
Jealous.
More than jealous.
Murderously hate, jealous.
Hate.
Yeah, okay.
This is along the same lines as that question. How is the German part of you different from the Japanese part of you in your writing and in yourself?
In my first year in Germany, I had the feeling that there was something like German speaking I and Japanese speaking I, two persons. But now, in the last 20 years, maybe not. I created myself. It's a mixture of many cultures, and it is not separated.
And when they were separate, what was the character of each? Because before you said something about a lion and a tiger.
It's a good question. Maybe Japanese speaking, I expected that other people know what I want. You know, I didn't have to say what I want. The other people must know what I want to eat now, if I am hungry or if I I'm cold or so. And I was, you know, the relationship between I and you are not the same in Japanese and German language in thinking. And also, we don't say the word I usually in Japanese, and also not the word for you, but in the gesture or in the movement of the soul, you can understand what you mean. I don't say I, but I say the verb, I say something, and before I pronounce it, the meaning of I is coming from my body, not as a language. So non-verbal part of the language is very big, bigger than, or the most important part of the language communication in Japanese is non-verbal. It is not pronounced.
Yeah. This question is related to the question from the aspiring writer and how you know if somebody is understanding your work. I'm wondering if along the way of to publishing something, you share your work with people to get their feedback and observations and then incorporate that into your revisions, or if you are very solitary in your production. That's one question. The second question is about how you see the relationship between reading and writing. I mean, it seems for any writer, the two are closely related. In your work, it sounds like, to me, even just judging from today's talk, that they're very intimately related. From the way you describe seeing a translation of your work and how that helps you understand the original, your own, and also this wonderful reimagining of Kiyomori speaking interlaced with Italian. It's there's writing added on to a reading in that case. Yeah. So the second question is general, how you go about dividing up reading and writing and how they interface with each other, and more simply, what are you reading these days?
Yes, in the first text, the writing was reading, and writing was translating. I just started to translate the Heike Monogatari, the part of Heike Monogatari, into German, but translating is not just translating, it's changing in writing. But sometimes I want to create my own world and I don't read any book, you know. But still, writing is reading, I think, because I can't write, because I read the books I write. So the writing is reading. Yeah. And the first question was about publishing, right? Yes, it's quite different from my German publishing and Japanese and English, because in Germany, I met the publisher, Claudia Gerke. She has a small publishing house, and I stay with her. So all my books, all 21 books are published by her. And in Germany, you stay by one publisher. So you don't change the publisher. Well, you can change, but then you publish one by one publisher. In Japan, you must publish by this book by this publisher and the next book in the other publisher, you must change. So I have many publishers, and they are big ones, Kodansha, Shinchosha, and so. It's not personal relationship. I don't love my publishers, you know. They are just big houses. And Kodansha makes many mangas, and so I don't have to write bestsellers. They have money, you know. And my French and English publishers, non-profit small publishers, is very good. I love them. The New Directions in New York City and Verdier in Paris, and also in my Dutch publishers is a very wonderful one. How was the name of it? Hootnote. Oh, yeah. I love small publishers and to meet the people who are making books and talk with them, discussing about how the book is looking, can look for.
Die Frage war aber ein bisschen anders, glaube ich. Hat gefragt, ob Sie, nachdem Sie was geschrieben haben, es andere Leute lesen lassen und oder für sich alleine schreiben.
Ah.
Ohne dass andere Leute das.
Yes, the publishers read always in any countries. Yeah. Read the what I wrote, and they make the comment. They write, what do you mean, or is it not, and so on. Questions, and you don't have to change anything, but you the publishers always read your manuscript. It's normal in each country. I don't show to the friends before that, I think.
My question's about your relationship with language and how you're creative with it and how it's changed, kind of. I think you were saying that you had two different identities of German and Japanese in the beginning, and so maybe you kept the languages separate, and now as you've come to create kind of like this, you know, intermingled new identity, do you play with the two languages and create kind of maybe a new language?
You mean create a really new language?
Just kind of like play with Japanese and German in your writing to create, kind of be more creative and.
Yes, of course. Because when I write in Japanese, it's not just the Japanese that exists today in Japan, but because I'm thinking also in German, I can imagine how Japanese can be, could be, or will be. And it's a possible Japanese, not only real Japanese. And it is possible to me because I can think in German. And also because my mother tongue is Japanese, I understand the German language differently than the German mother tongue people. And I create, even if I don't want, I create my Japanese German.
Right. Yeah. So does your Japanese, since it's your mother tongue,
yeah,
sound foreign sometimes to Japanese readers?
Yes, yes, of course, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
One question, two comments.
Oh, okay.
You said, I know nothing about Japanese, as you know, that in Japanese, the nonverbal is most important.
Yeah.
And how on earth do you transmit that through the written language, the literature?
Yeah, they are also not written in the written literature, but between the lines, you can imagine what. It's not the same like in the oral communication, but in the written Japanese, the word for I, for example, you don't have to write it. No, usually you don't write it, but it is, you can understand it from many reasons. You must study Japanese, I can't explain it, but you know that what is the subject of the sentence.
Okay, we're back in the in-between spaces in language in order to understand that which is not expressed.
Yes, but I think also in German you don't have to write ich, I, and you don't decline. You mean, you know, it is also the philosophy of what people want to have in the language. For example, when I write now, morgen gehen zur Schule, you know, tomorrow going to the school, just like this. It's not the correct grammar, but in the context, you can understand that I mean myself and I'm going to the school tomorrow. It's understandable, and in this direction, the language can develop in this direction. But sometimes you don't do that, but it is possible. It is understandable.
Okay.
If you write ich, always ich in German, it's not because you don't, otherwise you don't understand the sentence, but it's just the grammar, you know, the rule.
Okay. And the feeling comes through.
Hmm?
And the feeling comes through nonetheless.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll try to understand.
Yeah, yeah.
But I am remembering something when you were here in 99 and your English was just at the beginning.
Yeah.
We went to the theater to see an English play.
Yeah.
Which I didn't understand very well. And you were so enthusiastic and excited and
Irish one.
Understand feeling about the language.
Yeah.
Thanks.
I wonder if you belong to an informal club of writers writing in non-native languages today. I mean, I know Conrad and Nabokov are dead, but there's Alexander Hamon, who was born, I mean, he's Bosnian, I think, originally. I always mix up former Yugoslavian territories, but Bosnian, but writing in English, and in a really remarkable English that is obviously affected by it not being his native tongue. I wonder if you've had conversations with him or with anyone else who's doing comparable things today.
Yes, of course, yeah, many of them.
And what secrets do you exchange between you?
Yeah. Yeah.
It wasn't really a yes or no question.
No, you mean... No.
I mean, do you think about similar things? I mean, does it, in your discussions?
No, it's not similar. No, the, mm-hmm. but we are friends. You know, the shamiso family, we call mm-hmm. it. We all just, and we have the common the event together, mm-hmm. and we meet and we discuss. But not similar things. I think most of them are interested in not directly in the language, but they want to tell the experience in other cultures in German mm-hmm. language. So the German language is a tool for to tell mm-hmm. the story. But my interest is, primary interest is to work with the language itself, you know, the German mm-hmm. language or Japanese language or language itself. So
they think there's a thing they can write about, and you're not into that.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Sarah?
Hi. You read a really affecting poem about Fukushima and the disaster, and your story that's been translated, I think, was one of the first very literary stories that was is the Island of Eternal Return? Is that the right name that was in that? One of the first collections that came out in English of writings from Japan after the March 11th disasters. I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about your experience of writing about that event from the perspective of someone outside of Japan. It can be difficult to write about disaster from a close distance, but also from outside. The country of Japan. So I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about your experience of writing about after 3/11.
Yes, after Fukushima disaster, the Japanese writer wrote about Fukushima too, but they wrote the iyashi no bungaku, that's a healing. Yeah, you know, they are very careful about. They are not critical, and they are not dramatic, and just a very softly gentle stories about Fukushima. But I was in Berlin, and I wrote a catastrophe, like the something like science fiction in 20 years in Japan, that old people cannot die, and all young people are sick, and so on. And that story, I wrote it. It's very natural reaction from my side, but Japanese people are shocked about this story, and it's writing from outside.
Did anyone say you have no right to write from so far away?
Sorry?
Did anyone suggest that you have no right to write about this from so far away?
Something like that.
Most of them were watching it on TV.
I was just wondering if you could comment on what your process is. Do you go back and revise? And when you go back and revise, do you sometimes feel tempted to insert something of the other language? So how do you revise a lot, or is it pretty much the way you write it the first time? And if you revise, is there edit?
Yes. Yes, I read every morning. I wrote one day before and change all words. That is stanze. So,
but just one day, the 24 hours.
No,
and then you don't go back.
No, every day.
Every day.
You know, the day after that, I change. Mm-hmm.
And do you sometimes feel the temptation to insert the other language in there in part, or to do it in the other language, or does it always stay in the original language in which you wrote it?
No, when I am writing Japanese, for example, my critical German-speaking, I read it and change it, and I don't stay in one language.
Okay, I think we may be done for now. So
yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.